Hello and good morning, or afternoon, or evening, wherever you happen to be. In this video, we're going to be looking at a shader that I've been putting together that's basically trying to take draw calls and cut them down on an asset by allowing you to use vertex color to assign different material types to those vertex colors. That should allow for you to go from, let's say, 3 draw calls to something like 1. What we're going to be covering in this video will be the entire shader setup. I'll be looking at material functions, material blend nodes, and how we're blending all of those material functions together, how we're integrating dirt on top of all of that, and then we'll look at how I integrate a unique normal and how the detail normals work per vertex color. Without further ado, let's check it out. Okay, so first we've got a kind of, I guess you could say like a constant or a generic material setup where we've got access to vertex color to help us separate material types. So if we look at the way that you've got these 3 colors here, what we're seeing is red, green, and blue. We've got a detail normal in there as well as like a primary, let's say like baked normal, if you want to call it that. It's kind of how I've set it up in the material. So if we look at it, I'm just calling it a tri material or a tri matte constant. And we're just going to kind of go through and break down what we're seeing in the shader. So just to kind of keep things organized, I am looking at things like material functions in order to kind of keep the spaghetti at bay when possible, if you know how that goes. And that, for anyone who doesn't know, a material function is basically just if we hit control spacebar and we right click, you can make materials, you can make a material function, and a material function, if we just double click one of them, is basically just a material and it goes to an output result. Now, what's nice about that is then you can go to those materials. Let's see if we've got the... So this is one of the materials that was made. And when you drag it in, you just get that output result. And then you can do whatever you want with it, right? So with how we've got it set up here, I've got a constant red, constant green, and a constant blue. Let's go ahead and look at one of those before we continue forward. So this material constant red is the red color, right? And the reason I'm making it red is so that I, for debug purposes, will understand what it is or where it's placed when I see it on a material or on the mesh when I'm trying to understand, okay, what's happening here? Why is this not where I'm expecting it to be? So it's a good way of testing. The red vertex looks like red when you're building a shader, right? You can change this color later. So I've exposed it as a param. And then for the metallic, because I like to have like an on or off state, I've got a switch and a exposed bool parameter, which basically defaults as false. And if I say true, it makes metallic 1. So what this will allow us to do is when we have a vertex color of red, we'll have the control of making it metallic or not. It's just like a toggle. So you don't have like any of those decimal values. I've also got a roughness exposed. So we've got color, a metallic, and roughness exposed in the shader. And you'll see too, the way I'm naming them is in the chart, like when you make an instance of the material, I want it to be in order of red, green, blue. And all of the exposed properties will be in those said categories. So I made a group called zero red to make sure it's at the top. I know you can do some other things like priorities on, like their sort priorities. And I think you can arrange it in the shader as well. But I like to do that so that I'm visually seeing what it is no matter where I'm at, whether it's in a material function or if it's in the main material. So the group here is we're looking at red, zero red. And then I'm just putting R in front of my naming conventions to try and keep it all, just to give you an example of like what that means in the end. Let's move this over here. So if we look at this, so I've got zero red, I've got the color exposed, I've got the roughness, detail normal, which we'll talk about in a minute, and then I've got a metallic, which is just a switch, right? It's either true or false. And that's how this is all set up for the constant materials. And each one is the same setup. They're all exposed, but they're just red, green, and blue. And here they are. Because we're using material functions, we've got a material layer blend node, which is basically, I want the top material to be red. That way, I'm looking at it in this order still, so red, green, and blue. And I'm blending the green as another material to blend in, right? So it's blending between these two, and the alpha is the red vertex color. I do the same with the result of this going here, and the alpha now being the blue. So we actually don't use the green vertex color, because with this node, it's either red or green, right? And then with this one, it's either blue or red and green. So that's how I'm blending between all 3 of the colors, the material constants, with vertex colors. If we go here, this is when I start to integrate dirt on top. And I want this to happen on top of all three, right? I've got a dirt material function, which if I just open this up, is right now just a color and a roughness value, both exposed. Later, we could go in and change this to a texture that's exposed if we wanted to have a texture for the dirt and maybe something more complex than just a variable for the roughness. So going back to this, we've now got four material functions and we're blending between all of them, including the dirt, which is the fourth one happening at the very top. And then I've got a dirt mask. Now, this is one of the first masks that's part of this material. The idea of this material is to try and keep texture counts down and mesh calls down, right? So like if you have an asset with three meshes and this shader can support those three materials and give you the dirt and the baked normal and the detail normal control, maybe you can cut those three mesh calls into one and just use the shader instead. There are some limitations to the shader, like the constant three material functions are a different color and they're just colors. They're not like a texture itself. And they also just have a constant for their roughness as well. So right now these aren't too complex as it would bring in more textures in the end. So looking at the dirt, we've got a dirt parameter exposed and that'll allow us to increase the visibility of this mask to switch between the three materials or the dirt material function. So detail normal per vertex channel plus a baked normal. This is where most of the work had to go into the shader, as I was slightly confused as to how to organize vertex colors and their detail normals respectively. So instead of putting the detail normals inside of the materials themselves, I just put them in here because now I can readily access the detail normal strengths all together in one view. I've also added these little points, which you can get by double clicking a line and it'll add it. I did that just to kind of keep the line straight and then also put it here with a little note, because you can put a little comment on there. That way I don't have to be scrolling all the way back and forth. I can just see, okay, these are the vertex colors I can control or use. So what we've got here is we got our second map, which is a detail normal. I've also exposed this one as well as the dirt mask that we had earlier. And we've got our baked normal, which is happening on top or is being blended on top of the detail normal. So what's happening here, and Jonas in the Discord helped me clear this up so that I wasn't using too many flattened normal nodes, so thank you. So we've got our detail normal, we've got an exposed parameter, and we're flattening it based off of what vertex color is applied. So we've got three vertex colors, and we're multiplying them by a parameter that I've inverted. I'll explain the invert later, the one minus. And then we're adding these two together, adding these two together, and that basically gives us the output of our three vertex colors, which can be used as the mask for flatness on the detail normal. Now, what that means is with flat normal, this node, what value is going into here? So if we put a zero here and we could do this, the flatness value that's going into here, zero would be no flattening and one would be flattening. So you can see now there's no detail normal here. And I wanted to invert that because I wanted you to go like, it just from a user experience standpoint, when you're in the shader, to go from zero to one kind of feels like no detail normal to detail normal. By putting the one minus here, I was able to flip that. So now instead of one being no detail normal, we'll just do this really quick so you can see it. Now it's detail normal is fully on, and zero would be fully off. So that's what's happening here. I've got these defaulted to 0.5, and then I've got the max slider set to 2. So you can increase the strength of the detail normal 2 times, or you can bring it down to 0 and just kill it completely. And that's gonna be super nice for the flavor of like these three different material types that you could use the shader for. So like maybe this one, maybe the red vertex color is using metallic, right? So we've got our metallic toggle. And maybe it's a smooth metal, so we would want the detail normal to be 0. And then maybe on the green vertex color, maybe that's like a rubber. So we can control the roughness of that. Then we can maybe increase the strength of the normal on it. This is exposed, so you could swap the normal out for like an averaged, like expected normal detail. That's gonna be on the entire asset. And then you're just kind of controlling the strength of those. So you can completely turn them off if you want. It would be advised that you're using the nodes that you pay for to get the most variety out of one shader for three materials. The last part is the baked angle corrected normals node, which is basically us saying like, okay, you made a model, it's got three material types on it. Maybe it's got rubber, a plastic, and a metal. Those can be handled by these three separate vertex colors, but maybe you made a high poly and you baked it down as well, and that baked down normal can go here. So that'll be your base normal, and then the additional normal is the detail normal. That all gets plugged back into the chain for the material layer blends. And so now you can see with this string here, this is coming from all of the materials that are being blended together. It's going into here, and then the additional normal is all of this normal information we just solved here being added to that. That blend goes into here, which is a get material attributes. And the reason I'm doing this is that way we can do a mix of nodes and also use material functions and all of the material layer blends. The end result is you get this get material attributes node with the output you want, and you can just plug them into to what you're looking for. So just to explain get material attributes real fast, if you select this node, you can see here there's an array of elements. And if you click plus here, you'll just keep adding them, and it's going to add in the order that you see here. But you can go in and there's a little drop down. You can delete this. You can delete this one. Like, let's say we just want base color, metallic, roughness, right? So we can click this and we can say that one's going to be roughness, and we'll click this one and this one will be normal. So now we've got all those outputs, and then you can do this, and it's basically splitting out those attributes from this material, which has all been packed down into like a single node and a single line. But it's, if you open this up, you can see it's basically doing all of that in the background for you. So we break these out, get that end result, and then we get to this guy, which is right now just three colors because that's how we've set them up, right? It's got the macro or the baked normal and then the detail normal, which you can see here. I should probably also state the detail normal is defaulted at tiling at 15, and I've set the max to 50. I like to set minimum and maximum just because it allows for you not to accidentally drag into like the thousands range and like chug your computer for even a second. Just avoiding those scenarios is always nice. So let's look at the shader. So we've got these three. I'll bring this over and see how the guy will hide my camera. Let's bring this over here. Just pull this down. If you're wondering what this window is, it's just this, an instanced version of the material, the master material we built, and I just scaled that down and just shrunk this in. So with all of the groupings that I was talking about, so I wanted red, green, blue, and then the dirt, detail normal controls, and then the maps. That's the order I wanted stuff in, right? So I just put numbers in front. And again, I know you can probably set up the order in the, I think you can do it in here. So yeah, you can move grouped data around to try and like reorganize how this all looks. Maybe I'll do that later and then I can get rid of the numbers. This works for me, so it is what it is. Okay, so I'm just gonna bring this up here and so we can look at everything. So now you can see we've got red, green, and blue. They're represented here. This is a single mesh. And the reason that this is red, green, and blue is because in the vertex color of the mesh, these are red, green, and blue vertex color has been assigned to the vertices of the mesh. So now I can turn this on and actually like go in and change the colors of these, which is super nice. You can turn this to whatever you want. Like let's say we want no color and the value is gonna be pretty high, and we're gonna make this pretty reflective, and then we're also gonna say that it's metallic. And you see it. Now we've got a metalness value there. And that detail normal is on there, as you can see. The detail normal default is 0.5. I'm just gonna type in 0, and now you have a metal type material. Maybe for the green one, we'll go with like, we can get the value quite low, maybe saturation lower, call it good. We got the detail normal there. Of course, that detail normal doesn't really look like rubber noise or like a surface noise that could be happening. Maybe we can bring it down to like 0.25, get it really weak. You can see here, tiling wise as well, we've got like an exposed detail tile. So if we need to, we can tile it up more. And with a lower value, it might even look a little better, like as a plastic. And then we can go into the roughness and push it even more rough. So maybe we're looking at kind of a pretty diffused plastic. It's nice though, there's a lot of control here. If you want it to be really reflective, you can just turn this up within reason of PBR values. And it's, I mean, it's the same thing for the blue color, right? Let's just bring this down, lighten it up a little bit. Leave it there. We'll keep the detail normal where it's at. Maybe we'll make it a little less reflective. Let's say like 0.4. So we've been able to mess around with these three attributes, and you can kind of throw in whatever you would like. If you want to change the baked normal, it's been exposed, right? So you can just check this on and then swap the normal out to whatever you would like. That baked normal is going to be shared across all three, of course, so keep that in mind. The detail normal as well can be swapped out. So if you want, like, if you know a lot of your materials are going to be rubber-like, you can get a detail normal that looks more accurate for rubber surfaces, and that'll give you that control. And then the dirt mask, which we haven't really looked at yet, so let's do that. So the dirt color can be exposed, as well as also the roughness. It's defaulted to 0.85, just as like a value that seemed natural to me. So we got this surface here. You can turn the dirt on. It's defaulted to 0, so you're not seeing it. So you can, when you turn it up, you'll see the mask is coming in, and it's also affecting the roughness. So if we go and grab the roughness here, we can zero that out if we wanted to. It gets a little weird, I would say. So I think a 0.85 is pretty good. And if we go to our buffer visualization and look at roughness, you can see the dirt's kind of adding an extra layer breakup to the roughness values. One thing that I have not set up that I would advise doing is if you go and you look at the buffer visualization and we go to metallic, the metallic values are now starting to get gray information, and that's not what you would want. It might be a matter of just authoring the dirt mask to be a little bit higher in contrast, or building it in the shader to kind of avoid that. Also, you can see there's some crazy information going on here, and I was trying to figure out what it was, and I've realized that there's a little bit of red vertex color in likely in these points. So some of that information's coming over. Good times. But yeah, that kind of sums up this material. So the idea of this material, again, is to cut down on draw calls and give you more flexibility with less textures. You can see that with this setup, we're only bringing in three textures. And if you're using a family of detail normals throughout your entire project, you're going to be using far less detail normals anyways. So being able to swap detail normals is usually pretty easy to do, and use whatever works best. They're usually quite small textures as well. Hopefully that was helpful and or insightful to some people. And I guess we'll talk later. All right. See ya.